elemental effects are very popular in the particle illusion emitter library. But what happens when you want to take that further? We're going to be looking at how we can take a fire preset and then fattening it up, making it our own into one big giant inferno, and how we can then use that in other projects. So let's take a look at particle illusion. Creating natural elements like fire and smoke have always been a big go-to for particle illusion, whether it's something like a natural wall of fire, or more stylized anime or anime dot flame type of affair. The presets you get with particle illusion give you a huge amount of choice. And in this exercise, we're going to be looking at how you can get even better fire by layering different elements together. Now, in previous tutorials, we've covered filtering, auditioning, and favoriting the type of emitters that you want to use. And when we have a subject that is as expansive as fire and smoke, this is even more important. I am going to start off, though, with an emitter fire 01. But here's a little trick for finding some of particle illusion's most complex emitters. If we type in the subject matter and then type in colon PE, we're going to get some of particle illusion's most premium emitters. And out of these, I'm going to choose fire 01 as my starting off point. You can see here as I preview this around, this is going to give me quite a lot of fire. Okay, so let's change our layout back to the default layout. And I will just double click to add this onto the stage. And as we can see, by default, this emitter is going to be a line emitter. So I'm going to set my point down at the bottom left-hand corner, hit escape, and then change my other point to the bottom right-hand corner. And just place that towards the bottom of the stage. So as we play it through, we get our flames coming in from the bottom there. This isn't quite looking how I envisioned it. So let's give us a little bit more space by going into the edit layout, coming into the properties of our emitter. And we can see here that our fire is being emitted at points. Now this is really interesting, and we can increase the number of points that we get. And we get this kind of uniformed amount of fire being emitted all at points. And we can also see that this particular emitter already has zoom keyframed in. And that's what's giving us this nice, puffy, natural looking sort of flame going woof, woof, woof. There we go, a good one there. So I'm just going to increase the size over here because I don't want to muck about with any of the keyframes that currently sat on zoom. So I can easily increase size. If I need my flames to go higher up, then we can also increase velocity just a little bit. And this is giving us quite a nice base, but it doesn't quite have the depth that I'm looking for as a motion background. We're missing one big thing, and that's like some nice, rich, heavy smoke. If I open up this smoke fire, we see, oh, this is interesting. We know what this means. A lot of our parameters have F before them, and we know what this means. This means that this is a super emitter. Now, I could go in here, and I could try to adjust these and add more elements in here. But I think one of the easiest ways of doing things, one of the fastest ways of doing things, is to actually just add in another emitter onto the stage to build it up in that way. So I'm going to come back to my default layout, and I want to find something that is a bit more smoky. So I could look for something like smoke. And we have some of our sort of basic smoky type things here. Ooh, some smoky fireworks, there we go. So we've got stuff with smoke in it. But sometimes you need to kind of think outside the box, especially with the presets. So if we type in something like clouds, some of these clouds could be used, maybe not these particular clouds. Some of these clouds could be used and adjusted up a little bit to create up some more smoke going upwards. Or one of my favorites to use, where are you? There we go. Is in the dust and fog, which is the seeds and clouds here, which gives us a nice rolling cloud. We can easily take away the seeds. For this one, where we're going for a very big, rich, fiery look, I'm going to just get away from these nice fluffy clouds, and I'm going to look for Inferno, because that's really what we're after. And I've got Inferno Intensive or Super Inferno. And let's go with Inferno Intensive here and do the same sort of thing. Just going to position my line emitter just down here. Let's come back into the edit view, edit layout, bring that in there. I'm just going to disable Fire 01 so that we can focus on our Inferno Intensive, and let's see what is happening here. Oh, it's so little. It's so little in comparison to the other one. Let's open this up, and I can see that my zoom hasn't been used in this one. And it gets there, but it gets there quite slowly. So I'm going to preload a few frames so that our animation starts at the beginning. So I've preloaded 40 frames up there. There we go. I'm also going to zoom this up a little bit more. And increase the number. There we go. So that's a bit more Inferno-y. So I'm going to reposition this down here. And let's see what that looks like in context. So enable my other flames. Let's bring that up. And now we've got the nice black smoke happening, or nice black smoke coming in from the Inferno. And our regular flames are coming in there as well. Maybe that's a little bit too opaque. I'd knock the opacity down on the Inferno there to maybe about 60%. Cool. But now we've got two emitters fighting over what's happening. And we've got this intensive Inferno, which is very intensive and a little bit overpowering happening. And going over the top of our original fire, which I liked so much. So let's close some of these up a little bit here. Now, we've got a layer order when we have multiple emitters. And if I click on the hamburger menu, you can see I can move an emitter down now. If I do that, it looks like nothing's happened here, but all we have to do is just play it back or move it to a different frame, and that will refresh the view. So now we have our intensive Inferno going behind the other flames. And I can adjust that up as I need to now. So maybe reposition that just a little bit. So maybe come into my Inferno, reposition that a little bit. There we go. So it's in the right place. Yep, I like that. Let's play that back. There we go. Now we've got that nice intensive fire plus some of the black smoke that we have from the other emitter. If I didn't want the fire at all from the intensive Inferno, obviously I can come down here and turn off my intense here, which is, I assume, is going to be the flames. Disable that, and that gets rid of that and just gives me the smoke. But I kind of like that intensity that the double flames gives. Just because I'm not one for subtlety, I'm going to very quickly add one more thing over the top here. Come into our default, and I need a few kind of sparks. So let's see what we have for sparks. We've got sparkly clouds. That's not the sort of sparks I'm after. Bang sparks, no. Swirl storm sparks. Yeah, that's sort of more my thing, I think. So double click that on there. And this is immediately applied at the top, which is not really where we want it. We want it sandwiched between the intensive Inferno and the fire itself. And I'm going to bring that all the way down to the bottom here. Let's start that at zero. Let's tweak this up so it's got a little bit more velocity. And we can come in and pick a screen color. There we go. So that it's tinted much more in keeping with what our flames are. I could come in and I could tweak this up a little bit more. But I think that's doing what we need it to do. Cool, and I am ready to render this out now. And after the render, I've brought it in and made a little composite with it. So let's see what we've got here. All I've got is the original background we just rendered out. And then I've got a little background with a little gradient over the top, just so that when we put the fire in there, we get a little bit more glow happening. And there's my fire text, which I've got a light wrap over the top, just so we've got some of the light from the background blending in over the top. And I've got another copy of my fire here with just a linear wipe over, which we can see, let's bring that off, just to bring the fire over the text in a quick way. And that's a way we can use this composite from our Particle Illusion standalone. If we're working with the Particle Illusion plugin, we could do that fire in a little bit of a different way. If I come in and make a new layer, and I'll call this one Particle Illusion Fire, I will apply Particle Illusion to this black solid and launch Particle Illusion here. And I'll open up the project I just created, which is 07 Fire. There we go, that's the one. And I'm going to turn off my background, which is the Inferno Intensive. So just going to disable that and apply that over the top. And within the plugin, we can choose different composite modes. Alpha plus apply mode. I can just bring that over the top, maybe put an apply mode over that one as well. So that's a lighten instead. And I can make any sort of changes I need. Maybe bring my flames up a little bit and they'll just go directly over the top of my text. Maybe I'll screen those in, take the opacity down to 60%. And we can do any sort of small changes we need to directly within the plugin effect there. One of the other advantages of using the Particle Illusion plugin is it gives us access to the effects browser. Now, when we're saving our emitter presets in the Particle Illusion interface, we're only able to save one emitter at a time. With the Particle Illusion plugin, we can be using and saving multiple emitters, forces, and deflectors to get the effects that we're after. But regardless of whether we're using the Particle Illusion plugin or the Particle Illusion standalone version, we can still end up with some excellent results just by the clever use of layering up different particle emitter presets. So in this exercise, we've gone through the procedure of previewing and auditioning different types of fire, finding the ones that work for us, and then adding them together. To learn more about Particle Illusion and all the different sort of things you can do with it, then take a look at some of the other Getting Started with Particle Illusion tutorials with me, Ben Brownlee, and John Dickinson. So thanks very much for watching this one, and I'll see you again soon. Bye for now. Download Particle Illusion Standalone for free at boriseffects.com, including thousands of free emitter presets. Continue watching this Getting Started tutorial series to learn more about what you can do with Particle Illusion, and find out more about the plugin version of Particle Illusion with extra features, including built-in Mocha motion tracking, at boriseffects.com.